cinema culture is, which they understood something not only to enjoy the films, but also to research the world, or let's say to make sort of the understanding of the wider things than just what the cinema institution is. So he comes from that platform, intellectually, and more than that, Dušan Makavejev will discuss these things with Branimir. He was also very much involved in the cultural policy kind of organizations, let's say the organization for the voluntary labor of the youth which built the roads in Yugoslavia. So he was like a, let's say, a socialist, and he was very much influenced. He always repeats that in his interviews and recollections from Yugoslav surrealist movement, which was very active in practice, and at the same time also very political, artistic kind of tendency. So we have the film director who was directly involved with the, let's say, the new kind of the political forms in Yugoslavia, but also at the same time interested in advancing the artistic form. So the film you will see is made in 1968, and it is a film inside the film. If you read a little description, it is like a let's say an expansion of a found material. Film itself is telling that. It's like, it's not a mysterious film. Actually, it's a quite a simple film. Even in fact has this kind of film inside the film inside the film. There are like three layers of the archive materials: one, a fiction film, and then his actualization. So film is important of today's prevailing tendencies in art practices, that is, we deal with the past, with the memory and collective memory, and at the same time how to find correct form to represent that past. So, other than that, Dušan Makavejev made many films. He made a film on Viennese actionist, he made a film on Wilhelm Reich, was involved in many contemporary movies. So, let's watch this film, and then we will have a, we will open further than those films.
Aspect is like a word to mention
with Dušan Makavejev. I already did mention a few facts about his biography, about his intellectual, artistic formation, his involvement with many socialist cultural organizations and political organizations, and they really contribute to his filmmaking. So he is not an artist who was completely like just interested in making movies, but understood his making movies as some sort of larger political social responsibility. I mean, this is very, I don't know how to phrase this, like a social responsibility. He had a quite precise definition what that political and social responsibility meant in Yugoslav socialism while he was doing his films. I mean, one was to have this very secular approach to artistic practice, of course, to eliminate all sort of mystical, metaphysical remnants that are around the film, you know, like there is something of this filmic thing. And then I think that also is something that we should discuss. Yes, like precisely here with this film, I mean, that's maybe my intention to start from a difficult point, is like his relation to reality, you know, like what actually Makavejev in this film understood as a reality and the projection that a film generally, as a cinema I'm talking about, as a film, not a particular film, but generally, but watching a film, that active kind of that relationship has, you know. And here maybe not to make it like a big detour, to enter directly, you know, like what is, how he thought a relationship between the dream and reality. So let's give one particular scene here, which is that in the beginning when a woman was approached by this villain, awful rich man, and she looks from the window in the original film, and what she sees actually is, film is made in 1940s, you know, 1942, so Belgrade is in the war, and in the film, the original film, you don't see that. So the film, what is filmed, made in 19, during the occupation, that is about that melodrama, sort of, you know, very affective story. And what Makavejev does in that dream, which is not corresponding to reality, he is imposing yet another dream, which is not in that reality of that movie. So it's a, let's say, a doubling the what film does, what film should do, and he opens to a view that we don't see in the Belgrade, that is the war. It is actually a bomb, Belgrade bomb in the area of 1941. That's the documentary material. So maybe we can enter from this aspect.
Maybe our public doesn't know anything about what is the sentiments in Yugoslavia between 60s and 80s, where starts and promote the black wave, and you some kind put little trace to understanding that this is period of liberalization in your text, who some kind of animated text of all your curating team. But yes, this is the period of liberalization of Yugoslavia, and Black Wave is a part of this liberalization. How to take this separate segments of history of Yugoslavia between 60s and 80s. Because Black Wave started the 63 with Žika Pavlović, the return of Al Capone film, one very interesting film. It's noir film, totally of the shooting at the margin of Belgrade, the part of Belgrade with Bulbuder, who is originally part with Robert criminal during the after the Second World War, during the war and after the Second World War. And some kind, maybe the street movie, that is the last street movie of Makavejev from 74, I think.
Ah, yes,
three, 73 is the last film of Black Wave, some kind. Maybe in this moment he doesn't care.
Yeah, the historiography goes with that film, this long it was Grab City, to the Lazar Stojanović plastic Jesus, 72, more or less.
Yeah.
And the Maestro and Margarita of Alexander Petrovich.
Who is not part of the Black Wave since yeah. Sargani.
Yes.
In the, Black Wave is not a self-naming of group of albums. Yeah. This is some kind of stigmata of ideological mechanism in Yugoslavia that occur this group of amateur filmmakers. This is all amateur filmmaking. Dušan Makavejev is a psychologist, Žika Pavlović is a painter, Jan Mežir is a
lawyer.
Yes.
Study law.
Yes, study law, yes. And he is started to some kind of very in this time from 50s to early 60s started to produce film in very amateur context in Belgrade. This is the name of his organization is Kino Club Belgrade, who is one very old house, who is from early 20th century and very destroyed, and he produced film in this very the non-ambitious film, very short film. For example, the first one of Makavejev is the 6 minutes short film. The name is Izbor za mis, kako se kaže, Izbor za mis.
Selection
for fashion. And this is shooting in the caserna of military. Yes, with the soldier. And in this time, the normal part of all member of Yugoslav people army is one mirror, little mirror, where who is the part of how must look one proper member of Yugoslav people army, but on the background of the mirror. Obviously, it's be some beautiful girl from. This is production of this type of. And Makavejev shoot the film in a military situation when one to one go to the member of soldier and put the. Backside of the mirror where is different beautiful room, and this is some kind of izbor za najlepšu ženu, the beautiful woman on the castle. This paradox that in the castle doesn't weigh woman, choose and research where is the woman in the castle, and he this some kind of this is very comic effect that soldier give them this kind of some kind of fashion event in Yugoslavian military in 50s, who's very dark at this time. This is the for example of his first film, short film.
Yes, but also he has these films that he made in Esperanto language.
Yes.
Mid-50s.
Yes.
And then the film from like, we shouldn't believe to statue of yes. conditions on the amateur, but it was yes. sort of an attitude.
Yes.
It was an attitude, again, I repeat what I said in the beginning, to go beyond the institutional cinema, let's say, outside of an institutional cinema, and to use the filmmaking as a various experiment of research, of making comments on history or the social political
yes.
contradictions.
Yes, but the effect of Black Wave in the moment that this amateur group produced many other products about film. Not film is not his main focus. He produced many journal about film, theoretical discussion,
published a book. I want to mention a bit. In 1964, Makavejev published a very small book, which is called Kisses to a Comrade Slogan.
Yes.
And he is there analyzing his experience in the voluntary youth brigades, which he worked. And this amazing book, he there develops a very dadaistic theory of what makes a political slogan strong. And what he did, he was describing how actually reality is in the nighttime, in the cultural activities of these youth voluntary brigades in Yugoslavia. And then he makes sort of like a linguistic, semiotic research. Of course, he was not an expert on that, but Makavejev is an artist, let's say, like Kazimir Malevich, who goes to the end of what they discover, so takes the logical consequence of that discovery. What he did of the status of the language, of the political language, in that kind of collective works, to the end. And he said it is not only the semantic level, which is the level of the slogan that you understand, let's say, collective work advances self-management and this kind of thing, but the way how this is formulated, so the very form of that slogans are, is very interesting. Mm-hmm. Little book in 64.
Yes, but in this film you have some strategy of, not film strategy, but some kind of design, paper design strategy, how deal with the photography. He drew the part of film to see. Also, the cut is like graphic design, is some kind of graphic design. Because behind this film, in all Dušan Makavejev film is Branko Vukčićević. This is one guy who is in the credits, but very strong, modest.
Assistant of scenario.
Assistant of scenario, but his influence is most bigger than that. This assistant regia or director assistant.
He is appearing in the film when he gives the food to Alex.
Yes.
in the garden.
And Makavejev also is one part of the film.
Since we start with this encyclopedic knowledge, you know, but important thing is to mention also some things about Branko Vukčićević. He's a guy when this US writer, Caroline, what was his name? The Gray, her name is great, who wrote a book, A New Russian Experiment. It is the first English language book on Russian avant-garde. And all that she went to Russia and immediately after Second World War and collect amazing material. So all the US minimal artists like Donald Judd and others, they actually get into this idea of the suprematist painting of Malevich and things like that from... Yeah. How can I not remember her name? Great. Anyway, so...
this is his first book.
It's a first book on Russian avant-garde, okay? But when this book came out, Branko Vučićević wrote to publisher that there is 220 mistakes. And then you wonder why, how is possible that a person who lives in Yugoslavia has such knowledge. But they did. And that's like something very interesting to also think, to reflect of these references, including knowledge of his Medved King, which in the West it was not available, let's say, until like the 60s.
And this is a very important part of all Makavejev's film, after that. But this sequence of when grow, and it is very important part of this is the producer of film, this is our film. In this time our film be in a very big cooperation with big Hollywood production and he this production house Aula is some kind of produce the American film in Yugoslavia many from the 60s to 70s and in this time the director of our film want to produce some experiment and to give the money to these people who doesn't have money for film anyway. And he produced this time from 67 to 73 this opus and the most known film of this period is Jeremy Zilnik.
Early works.
Yes, early works who in, I think, 69, Gold Beer.
Gold Beer.
Yes, in Berlin Biennale winner. Most important moment in the productional and after that, this is the spitz of some kind of spitz of this. But after that, he disappeared to the world. Makavejev goes to America and deal with some producer, independent producer. Really goes to Germany and live about 3-4 years.
Makavejev's trajectory was like this. He, after this film, which is the end of this trilogy that he did in Yugoslavia, he made a film called Mystery of Organism,
yes.
French co-production,
yeah.
About Wilhelm Reich.
Yes.
It's very interesting film. It is about more or less a comment of like how is different Yugoslavian socialism from Soviet socialism and especially this very...
Yeah, and American capitalism.
Yes. And because there is like a Wilhelm Reich who was thrown out both from the psychoanalytic society and from the Communist Party. And then he made a film with a Dutch co-production called Sweet Movie, where Otto Muhn, this Vienna Axionist group, is acting. The core of this film is the Katyn massacre. Katyn massacre is in 1939 when the Second World War started. The Russians, let's say Soviet Union, has killed thousands of Polish officers. Mm-hmm. So at the birth, so in 1940, during the massacre of the Nazi machinery, it was a big operation, international operation of unearthing these corpses. which was supervised by International Committee to supported or sponsored by Nazi state to in fact equate the crimes done by the Nazi regime with the Soviet Union. And so, I mean, there is a lot of writings about that, but he chooses that very difficult historical moment, well, like Katyn massacre is a headache for communists since like 1941, okay? But so, by dealing with that kind of some extreme, I would say, traumatic moments, Makavejev's principle in making film is always, that is quite interesting in him comparing to others, which are a bit more provincial, I would say, with the references, with the style, is to kind of use the potential of cinema. That is that dream, that's impossibility to live in it. You know, it's very hardcore kernel of like certain things that we always discuss, where things are really kind of like a meeting, you know, but then you can never go deeply. Like some sort of unconsciousness, you know, almost, let's say like that. Yeah, then continue, another thing, continue to make films about this question you did for Montenegro. It's a first film made about the immigrants, let's say Yugoslav immigrants living in Sweden, in the history that is not about the immigrants as a labor force, but treats the immigrants as a cultural identity. So it is, I would say, also avant-garde of postmodernism and a reactionary kind of understanding. So Makavejev is, you know, like crazy, maybe, but it's always interesting to deal because he always decides the most difficult, you know, the most kind of difficult thing. That's it. Into the contradiction.
Yes.
And.
But it's an interesting moment that after 1989, that socialism is broken down, he doesn't have any idea what he's doing. Only in the context of socialism he has some potential for creativity. After that he totally is loose in the... And this is my question about reality and dream. For you. For example, in this footage of in the time of Danish collaboration regime, you this is the most provocative part of the film.
Here I have the first. Yes,
this is the most because the history who promotes. Not Communist Party, in this time doesn't exist Communist Party. Communist Party go to the history of 1948. From 1948 you have no new political subject. This is the name of this political subject is Savez Communist Yugoslavia.
League of Yugoslavia.
Yes, League of Communist Yugoslavia. My thesis is that all revisionism in Yugoslavia started with 1848 with the moment that Communist League of Yugoslavia break with his revolutionary history who is promoted Communist Party of Yugoslavia. Because this is a total different ideology. Savez Communist Yugoslavia, the League of Communist Yugoslavia, is some kind promotes the non-conflictable history of Yugoslavia. And now, in this moment, we all know this kind of history of Yugoslavia. Who promote League of Communist Yugoslavia, who in very, very violent moments in the history of Socialist Federative Republic Yugoslavia, he disappeared and destroyed. Communist Party of Yugoslavia, SKOJ, this is a communist youth organization, and AFŽ, who is very important in the third sequence of Yugoslav revolution. This is the, from 45 to 48, when through the revolution of terror, nationalized all the private property. And this is the most important organization who, after 48, disappeared. And we have some ideological history who promotes SKU, who erased history of revolution. And on the other side, he hides the reality of Second World War in Yugoslavia. And Makavejev put the footage on the film, how look Belgrade during the occupation, 42. It's a quite, very quiet, regime in occupation without any resistance, without any problem from 41 to 44. When partisan communists came from the woods of Bosnia and make Serbia in during the occupation is very similar to France. Very similar. You doesn't have any military operation, all political and this is the, I think, the most important part where he put reality of the dream of history of who promotes from 48 League of Communists of Yugoslavia, who is not party, not is nothing, some kind of very early NGO organization. No, self-management is on the total other level. The last revolutionary sequence is the invading the social property between 48 to 52. This is the last revolution.
But how did you see this thing? You are seeing the missing partisan national liberation struggle.
Yes.
In the movie.
Yes, but this is only one sequence. We don't have any new history about 40, 41, 48. You have many new work, historical work, but you don't have any new history about 41, 48. No, this is only the communist leader of Yugoslavia hegemony and for the this day. But Yugoslav revolution is very complicated. It's not the sequence of revolution, the 41 to 43, where you have some kind of the class war sequence. After that, for 43 to 41, you have sequence of people liberation, when they grow up the state and take over the state mechanism. But after that, from 45 to 48, you have the class struggle on the end, the nationalization of all private property in this moment. And from 48 to 53, this is the last sequence. This is the only revolutionary census of Liga Communist of Yugoslavia. This is invading the social property. And this is the end of Yugoslav revolution, 53. But at the same time, Communist League of Yugoslavia, yes, he invited the new concept of ownership, who is a very, very revolutionary in the 400 years of history of Europe. This is the only new object. You doesn't have new objects, even the social property. But in the same time, in the superstructure, he promotes modernism. Modernism and social property doesn't have any.
But do you say that the revolutionary subjectivity of the Yugoslavia is written by the League of the... Was there apparatus?
History, yes.
What was the apparatus which was writing the history in the League?
History, classical modernistic history.
And does Dušan Makavejev belongs to that apparatus?
Yes, but after that, from 48 to 58, you have sequence, very, very tricky sequence. You have sequence who is the high in the history of League of Communist Yugoslavia. This is the anti-Stalinistic terror, who tried 10 years, very massive violence against other communists, his family, children, who tried 50 years. And the high, the strike, workers' strike during the 50s, who is very strong, because the workers believe that social property is a real stuff. But we have the seconds after 58 and Congress. This is the period of liberalization of Yugoslavia. But in this time, this sequence called dictator of middle class. And this is a period of very strong dictator of middle class in Yugoslavia. And this is the end of Yugoslavia.
In that general sociological level, of course, Makavejev belongs to that middle class.
Yes.
But I think with him, he was trying to get out. You know?
Yes!
He was especially trying to get out of that
middle class. You know, not get unified. Yeah. You have many tendencies in the middle class.
Yeah.
You have some kind of leftist, rightist, center. He's on the left side during the 10 years of his creativity. For me, go to right side.
Yeah, after eight.
Yes. After eight. And this is the problem. When we don't have history of one very big historian, Branimir Petranović, who wrote 10 books.
Big books, yes.
Yeah, 10 big books about history of Yugoslavia from 41 to 80s. On the end of career, 94 is very desperate and he wrote one very desperate book and very depressing book.
Very nationalist.
No, it's not that nationalist, it's very confused. Very confused at this moment, but his statement is very good. On the end of career, the historian who wrote 10 books about history of Yugoslavia, start book with the sentence, we historiography, for historiography, second Yugoslavia, this is socialistic Yugoslavia, is a unknown country. This is the first sentence. In the end of career, when write 10 books about, for 41, every 5 years, he give the very, very strong historiographical material and he's a professor of historian. And this is, for me, very interesting sentence that who for me, we think about what is mean with this sentence, the man who produced, he is a part of producing the history of Yugoslavia in perspective of League of Communist Yugoslavia, who is on 48 forbid to think and to write about this period of history. This is only the People Liberation Army segments is important. The class war is totally, and also the segments of class struggle between 45 to 48 is totally erased in this history. And this is the problem. We have the problem how to conceptualize the this period and in the conceptual way of thinking how divorce the war and the revolution on the first step. This is not same thing. And the other, how long is Yugoslav revolution? Where is the end of Yugoslav revolution? And what is the history of Yugoslavia? I am the end of this sequence of dictature of middle class during the 60s to 80s. This preparation, this process of privatization of social property, who is directly be part of massacre from the 90s. War in the 90s is war, how to steal social property. Nothing else for me. This story about nationalism, the hate between people in Yugoslavia.
This is just after effect.
Yes. This is a...
Well, I wanted to go to some very particular, let's say, a cinematic form.
Yes.
I wanted like artistic context, but it's very interesting. I mean, all these discussions about Yugoslavia, especially what you say, separation between, or what is the relationship between war and revolution. Because here, we in this film, we really see a war, you know?
And, yeah. Occupation.
Occupation, not so much war. Yeah, we don't see, we see the war schematized.
Yeah.
With certain like diagrams and lines, how states are invading other states and what are the economical background of it. But then again, it's true, you know, like the war was the main question of a conjunction from the beginning of the 20th century. It was the way how, let's say, Lenin separated from the Second International when First World War started, you know, having the position about the war without having to go into this kind of metaphysical anxieties about what is violence, what is even nationalism, you know, but like just to have a very clear position. What is the war? What is the war's relationship with today, which means with actual contemporary conditions, and who is benefiting? Obviously, the lecture on that from, let's say, like a professional political, what to say, technically middle class, you know, is always the representational, which means the states are doing the war. And what is erased from that story, which Branimir actually quite much made already the painting ready, is the people, you know, the people struggle, which is the subjectivity of the revolution. So I agree with you, people are excluded from the, in this movie, people are excluded. This is a very liberal understanding, and that's the limit of the whole Black Wave. Actually, I mentioned I wrote my PhD on Black Wave, and it's very critical. I don't deal with this with other film directors except Dušan Makavejev so much. Like for me, a concern of Živoj Pavlovich, it was never for me an interesting topic, or Aleksandar Petrovich even less. Maybe Jeremy Zhilnik to some extent, because they were quite really holding firmly into that position of a middle class. Makavejev has some disturbing moments, you know, has some this kind of the elements that I already mentioned is difficult to swallow, you know, like yes, middle class, yes, it is very much having that representation. When I say representation, it is always talking from the position of the state. You know, that does not put the art practice distance from the state. You know, distance from the apparatuses that we recognize as our language is generally the culture. He is there, but he always is spoiling in a way or trying to spoil. Of course, that's the limit of the art. I mean, generally, if you talk about limit of the art, it is that what you mentioned. Erasing of people, because it's difficult. There is not even the language. There is not even index of the language to talk about that. Mm-hmm. That's not. It's like very comfortably sitting on the bourgeois understanding of what is the culture. There is the pedagogical side of it, which continues, which develops, expands. You know. So in that general scheme, what you did, of course, I mean, like, what are we doing? Everybody goes to that basket.
But
some questions or some discussions, comments.
Maybe quickly on the what Branimir said about the history of class struggle in Yugoslavia. I mean, it's not so much on the film, but I was just intrigued by what you said with the class struggle in Yugoslavia post 44, pre 48.
45 to 48.
End of war, liberation accomplished,
yes.
Partisan struggle accomplished, yes. The beginning of the formation of the state, and now who gets what? So basically the faction that fought together against the Nazis now are engaged in class struggle.
Yes.
Until this is constituted, like 48, and then you said that a couple of revolutionary stages still until 53 maybe or 52,
yes.
And then basically the revolutionary period is over.
Yes.
Yes. But is it a classic moment of that the foundational, whatever, violent class struggle is excluded? This is the first thing to do when you have a state, basically.
No.
Can you have a state as ongoing class struggle? Don't say any Maoist stuff. What I mean?
Yes.
Can you? How can you organize a class struggle in a state?
In a state. This is the sequence 45 to 48. This is the sequence of nationalization of private. This is the class struggle.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Take over the private property. And this is end of sequence. But in this moment, you have 48 only the Russian model of state property, who is one of form of private property.
Yes.
Doesn't that end in 41? In 48, who invite the social property? This is a totally new type of property. And in the social property, you have promise that you produce worker state. This is the new concept, worker state. But in this moment, the Communist League of Yugoslavia doesn't want to produce the worker state. He produced during the 50s and 60s and 70s dictature of middle class, very strong dictature. You don't possess it
the means of production.
Means of production in private. You don't ruling class like in Gujarat, but you have very strong middle class dictator who doesn't want who prepare the position after the destroy social property. And from 68, for example, great poet Oscar Davicho said, in Yugoslavia and between us, artists doesn't exist. Communistic society take over by nationalists and the bourgeoisie. 67. But in this time, you have the stupid student demonstration revolution, who is totally naive, and out of any context, and because you, the most bigger secret of Yugoslavia is a social property. Now, the Praxis philosopher doesn't know anything about this, about Yugoslav revolution, about he goes to liberalization. It doesn't quote anything. He had reference to the revolution, but doesn't know how looked this revolution. He dreamed like Bolshevik, like Maoist, but doesn't have that. He has segments very strong, with a very strong proposition, historical necessity, and this is very complicated revolution. How Communist Party 41 changed that strategy, for example, for liberate territory to proletarian brigade. And why? This is a very big issue, because from he came from Liberation Republic, the little republic who is promoted like a part of liberated of occupation, but German came and destroyed Republic. And what is he want to think and to produce the new, totally new strategy with the proletarian brigade. And this is for the Moskva is a secret. For Moskva, this brigade he called Šestalička with the ethical naming, because Stalin doesn't want that to be class war. But Yugoslav Partizan with the proletarian brigade goes straight to the class war from 1941 to 1943. This is the most important sequence of
and maybe also we have to mention here, like not immediately after the war, but in 1948, Kocha Popovic has published, and it is translated in many different languages, Marxist-Leninist theory of the Yugoslav liberation war, and it is an answer of how Russian generals and officials interpret proletarian brigades, and it is. It is very interesting also to know who is he. He was from the very bourgeois family, from the richest family in Belgrade, Kocha Popovic, who in 1930s is one of the important Belgrade surrealists. He wrote a book on like subconsciousness, phenomenology of phenomenology, irrational, irrational. And then many other texts like that, but in the Second World War, he was the chief commandant of First Proletarian Brigade.
Yes.
Very responsible for thousands of partisans. And what is the very interesting thing, he has the war memories, published 80s. How he interprets, and that maybe there is of course a wish to interpret poetically what was the specificity of the Yugoslav partisan struggle, that contingency, singularity, but I think it's too much stretching into art and culture. No, I don't think
In this moment, he's not good.
But that
good witness, because the main, in a military sense, the main guy who is strategic thinking, the class war is a one non-communist in the glavni štab, the main quarter of partisan struggle. This is Arsen Jovanović, the one general who is be the officer in the kingdom military. He's a thinker. He's very smart guy, and he during the whole war he write a book about any event. He's a thinker, and this invent the military strategy, how to deal with the proletarian brigade, how his definition of Yugoslav partisan war. Duhi marš u kružnu kretelju.
Long march in circle
moon. Long march in circle moon. And this is for me the best definition of all history of this kružno kretelje, this circle movement is idea that we doesn't have the strategy to liberate the territory. The circle movement means we produce society, not produce this, produce them. And this is the new type of war for me. And the class struggle with this definition of Dugi March, the long march, this is very similar to Mao, of course, but he is not, doesn't know anything about communistic language. He is not communist in this time. Maybe after 45, but he's him, 48. For when he was killed,
he's killed in 48.
Yes, in Yugoslavia, for very, very mysterious circumstances. Is accused that he Stalinist 48. But after that, Branimir, this historian, said after 48 and death of Vaso Jovanović, whole mythical history of the war became a mythical story. Because all people liberation became actionar of Društva, actionar of people liberation struggle. Some actionar who
give the business.
Yes. After the kill, the main thinker and promoter of. And this is I personally don't believe that Kočapak Popovich never said any word about Arsenal.
Who is he says in the diary in quite an ironic way, actually.
Yes, he hates Arsenal because he's a thinker and a strategic mind. He's a commandant of one.
In a very competition.
Yes, it's been a very competition, but never any heroic hero of the Second World War after the death of Vaso Jovanović never say any word about his main military commander. This is for me fantastic.
Look, let's open up if anyone has anything to say after time, because then we go to sleep.
Okay.
Just one small observation. In the movie, you see people in the ground while they're watching him fly. So there were some people there.
Yes.
Okay. I would like to wrap it up if you agree, because this is a long conversation. Thank you very much for introducing this to us. Please come again for, you that are here, you cannot, but send me again for the lecture on Saturday the 28th, when we have another film, which is part of the same program. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.